أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين على سيدنا محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الكرام والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولا نذير له ولا مثال له ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن سيدنا وسندنا ومولانا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل عليه في الآخرين وصل عليه عند الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين أيها المؤمنون الحاضرون أوصيكم ونفسي الخاطئة بتقوى الله وطاعته إن الله مع الذين اتقوا والذين هم محسنون يقول سبحانه وتعالى يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به الأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا ويقول سبحانه وتعالى في محكم كتابه العزيز أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ومن آياته أنه خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في أحد من أحاديثه عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تنكح المرأة لأربع لمالها ولحسبها ولجمالها ولدينها فاظفر بذات الدين تربت يداك رواه إمام مسلم وإمام بخاري والآخرون I begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I ask him to send his peace and his blessings upon his last and beloved Prophet Muhammad, his family members, his companions, and all of those who followed his way of life until the day of judgment. And I bear witness that there is no God except Allah. I bear witness that our dear and beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah and his servant. The person who is guided on the straight path, on the path of Islam, no one can misguide that person. No one can lead that person astray. And the one who is not guided on the straight path of Islam, no one can guide that person on that straight path except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout His mercy and throughout His guidance. Dear brothers and sisters, one of the essential things for a young man or a young woman to know is choosing the right partner in life. The reason is because that young man or that young woman intends to spend the rest of the life with his or her partner. Therefore, this is very essential for each one of them. And this is today the topic that I'm going to talk about. Choosing the right partner in life. What the individual needs to look at in order to make the right decision, the right choice. But someone might ask, we understand that this topic is relevant to the young people who are looking to get married in the future. What about me as a parent? That is also important for every single individual who is present here today or anybody who is listening to this khutbah today. The reason is because you may be a parent, but you may have a daughter. And tomorrow, you will give that daughter in marriage to someone. And you need to know certain qualities that that man needs to have in order for him to marry your daughter. Or you may have a son. You also need to know what kind of a girl, what kind of a wife is he going to have in the future. So they can build a sound foundation for their future family. So it is not relevant only to the young people, but it is also relevant to almost every single one of us. And even if we're not parents, we can advise a brother of ours, we can teach him, these are the qualities you need to look for, or these are the steps you need to take in order to have a successful marriage in the future. So it is very relevant, but also in the society where we live in, sometimes the young people, they don't have guidance. Parents, they come from overseas, and because of their culture and the way how the societies back in their countries are built, they are unable to teach their own children how to look for the right person or how to establish a good marriage in a different society. Because when you have different societies, there are different cultures. There are different expectations. There are different ways how you look at certain things. Yes, we all agree that essential things are the same. Whether you live in America, you live in Europe, you live in Africa, Asia, anywhere in the world, the essential things that you need to look for marriage, they will be the same pretty much. However, some of the details, they can create problems. And these details differ from country to country, from a society to a society. Having a knowledge about these details as well, especially at the place where we live, considering the situation of the Muslims, it will help establish a good family in the future, based on sound foundations. Therefore, I want to start by mentioning the ayah that I mentioned when I recited the Arabic portion of the khutbah earlier. The ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Rum, verse number 21, he states, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. It is among his signs that he has created from you, of yourselves, spouses. So in other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator, is teaching us that the spouse being there, it is from my signs that I have created. He has created the male and he has created the female, both partners of each other. It is, he says, from my science. In other words, recognize my ability as a creator. He wants to draw your attention to recognize him being the creator. Being the creator of this bounty. Because it is a bounty to have a partner in life. It is from the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has bestowed upon humanity. So recognize that fact to begin with. And then the ayah goes on by saying, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا So you may find rest, you may find tranquility in your spouse. Tranquility comes from the word also sakina. لِتَسْكُنُوا There is a connection between these two words. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا So you may find that rest, you may find that tranquility in your partner or your spouse. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً And he has placed between you, between both of you, the husband and wife, love and mercy. In other words, when the couple marries, when they start living a life together, they're going to share two things. The number one, mawadda, love. Now some people who say that, or they stay away from mentioning these things, like what are you talking about? Why you love? You love your wife, you love your partner, that's silly. No, this is a part of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, and He is telling us, reminding us about this feeling that He has placed between the partners. So you may not only recognize that, but also develop that blessing that Allah has placed between you and your partner. So loving the husband, loving his wife, wife loving her husband, it is again from the bounties, from the grace that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the hearts of the partners. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً He has placed love and also mercy for one another. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ Indeed, in these signs, in them, there are, indeed, in this relation between the husband and wife, there are signs for people who reflect, people who think. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he talks generally about choosing the right partner in life, he states the following hadith that comes. He says that the woman can be married for four different reasons. And he mentions the first reason by saying, for her wealth. There's a lot of women that are wealthy. And he says that people marry women for their wealth. The father is rich, the mother is rich. So there are men who marry the woman for that reason, because of the wealth. And then he mentions the second reason by saying, because of her lineage, she comes from an honorable family. Therefore, people marry women because of their honor. The third reason he says, it is her beauty. That man marry a woman. He leaves at the end here. He states this reason at the end of the sentence. He says, the other source of marrying the woman is also because of her deen, because of her religion. And the Prophet ﷺ recommends us, recommends the youth to marry the woman because of
the deen.
And not because of these three other reasons, but because of the deen, because of her religion. And then at the end of the hadith, he states that may your hands be rubbed in dust. Now when you hear that, may your hands be rubbed in dust, first of all, what does that mean? That's a question that comes in your mind. Is that a wrong expression? Prophet is not expressing anything wrong here in this hadith, but this is just kind of a metaphoric expression which means that may you prosper. May you have prosperity if you're going to marry a woman based on her deen, based on her religion. And it is a problem nowadays when you see a lot of families, they look at the woman, they look at the wealth, how much she has, or they look at her education. This is the top priority. In many families, they look for the education, they look for their master's degrees, they look for PhDs and so on, how well educated she is. They don't pay attention to her character, what kind of a person she is. Sometimes they don't even get to speak to her, but they get that CV, they get that resume kind of a paper, which, you know, they see a picture there, and they see a couple of information, and she has master's degree, she has PhD. This is what matters. This is the most important thing. Okay, let's give our son to marriage. Or vice versa. They look for the same thing for a man. To be very rich and also to have degrees. Especially a doctor. If he's a doctor, even if he doesn't pray at all, even if, leave it. Maybe inshallah in the future, once they get married, then he's going to start the prayer. When he's married, then he's going to start his fasting and give charity and this and that. For now, he's young. He doesn't understand. He's young. He's 28 years old. He has finished the school to become a doctor, the medical school. He's young. What kind of analysis is this? Marriage should not be based only on the degrees that the young guy or the woman has. Marriage should be based, according to the Prophet ﷺ, looking at the status or the degree of their faith. How well they are in implementing what God tells them. And I'm not denying the fact that these other things are also important. But you have to make the priority deen first, religion. When you don't make that priority first, then you're going to start having obstacles on your way later. Now, I want to get into some of the steps that our young people, they can consider before getting married. And the first thing is waiting versus hurrying for marriage. There are a lot of people out there who advise the others. There's a lot of, you know, fathers and mothers out there who would advise the others, they would advise the children or the other people as well, the other young people, to wait for marriage. Wait until you finish your school. Wait until you finish your university. Wait until you get a job, you become an executive for this company, or you become a general manager for this and that, which may take 4, 5 years, 6, 7, 8 years. All of a sudden now you know, you come to realize that the son is 30 years old or 40 years old, and he already missed his time to get married. And he's so used to live by himself that he's not looking anymore for marriage. Same case with a girl. Let her finish. She's 20 years old, 24, 25, 30, 40 sometimes. And then all of a sudden, that is too late. And there are less candidates for marriage. So parents, they have a very important role in teaching and advising their own children. I would not recommend people to wait for a long time. But at the same time, I'm not saying that they should get married to an age where they don't understand the environment, they did not build their own characters, they don't know how to treat their spouses and partners in life. They have to reach that age, not necessarily just past the age of puberty, but realize all of these things that I just mentioned earlier. Be able to stand for themselves, be able to earn their living, be able to respect their partners. Sometimes marriage, whether you're young or old, can also be prohibited. It is haram for certain individuals. For example, an individual who knows himself that he is vulnerable to express or oppress his own partner. Beating up, right, his own partner. It is haram, for example, in that case when he knows for sure that he's going to do that. Apply force or oppress the partner. These cases are completely prohibited. But other than that, we should recommend our young people, our youth, to get married in a young age. Why do I say that? Even if they are in school, even if they are going through their medical school, the reason is because, number one, when they get married after their 30s or late 20s and all of that, it is, many times it is late. Having children, you know how important also it is to have children earlier. Because you don't want to have a child, you're 40 years old, and then you're 50, 60, you feel like a grandfather and your child is still growing. You cannot have a decent conversation, but when you're married earlier, in a younger age, you can treat your child in the future like a friend. So there's a different relation when you're younger with your child versus a relation when you're old with your child. And there are other reasons too, but I don't want to get into those details that much. I just want to emphasize on this point that getting married young is important. And remember, during the time of somebody can say, well, you know, they're going through schooling, so what? Even if they don't have to live in a separate house by themselves, even if they can still live with the parents, have them married. Have them married. Instead of the boy going and having a girlfriend out there, which it happens a lot of times, we should not deny these facts. The family is, mashallah, very religious, but the boy has girlfriends right and left. And sometimes we close our eyes and say, well, that's okay. When it comes to the girl, it's a big problem. And that's the case too in Muslim communities. We should not deny this fact either. So why would it be okay for the son to have a girlfriend and not get married? What's the problem? What's stopping that? Have them get married. They don't have to live a life as they would be living together. Yes, the husband would be responsible for his wife, and also wife has her own responsibilities as well. However, they can divide these responsibilities in a way that they can still go on with their schooling, for example, if they're going through schooling. Instead of having a child right away, they can delay it 1 or 2 years later, probably, in order to continue with these goals that they have in life. But don't prevent them from not getting married, because one way or another, a lot of them are going to end up committing these prohibited acts. They will get into the haram instead of having their own partners in life. So schooling, earning the livelihood, should not stop a couple from getting married. Another problematic thing is also that we look to have, in a boy for example, thousands and thousands of dollars to a certain amount where it is not possible by majority of the people to have. No, they're expecting, for example, $50,000 from a man to have, and the man may have some savings, but not to that certain amount. Lower the expectations. Don't make it hard upon people. Don't go to that such a level where you know for sure that it is above the average people to have. So don't put those expectations. And unless the man, for example, doesn't have $50,000, I'm not going to give my daughter in marriage. Even if the man is qualified, even if the man has a good job or the man has good qualities, the man is very religious, you know, they get blinded from these facts they have in front of their eyes. what they're paying attention to is the money. If they meet this quota of 50,000, then I'm going to give my daughter in marriage. Again, absurd things. Be more realistic. Take into consideration the place where you live, you know, the way how people live here. And then make that right judgment. And I'm not also preaching here that give your daughter, for example, in marriage to anybody who, whether they have money or they don't have money at all, that's fine. No, that also matters because you want to see that you are giving your daughter in marriage to somebody who is able to provide for himself and his family. Somebody who is able to save for himself and the family. Somebody who is hardworking. That is good. But don't put, again, those expectations when sometimes are unrealistic by the majority of the people to reach. Sometimes we also have a lot of pressure. And as I mentioned to you, a lot of parents who come from overseas, they come with the same exact expectations they have for the girls overseas or for the boys overseas. And it ends up for a man to marry someone according to their parents' expectations and not according to his own expectations. You should also take into consideration what the parents are saying. That is very important. But also you as a parent, you should take into consideration the expectations of your son or your daughter. Because if you don't, then you're going to have major problems with a new couple in the future. Because they did not get married based on their own expectations, but they got married based on your own expectations. And your own expectations are different from their expectations. What did you achieve? There are times when I do marriages here and there, and it happened that I would talk to young guys. You know, I'd say, did you talk to your future wife? Have you had a conversation with her before? Have you had a chance to know who she is, what she stands for, what are her values, what kind of ethics she has? No, parents just told me to marry, so I'm going to marry her today. And this is against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, sometimes, according to some cultures, this is okay. But that doesn't mean that I should implement my culture, especially in this society, simply because my culture teaches me that I don't have to get to know the girl, I don't have to even talk to her, when she's presented to me, I'm married to her, and that's the end of the story. No. This has to change. These mentalities, they have to change. Especially if it also goes against the teachings of our blessed and beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when it comes to pressure that leads to wrong choices, pressure from the society sometimes, like the society would like a girl that doesn't have hijab. It is more acceptable, according to the society, a girl that has no hijab. A girl that talks a lot. I don't have to fulfill these expectations because society has these expectations. I'm going to fulfill the expectations that my Prophet teaches me. That the girl needs to have that hijab. A girl needs to be humble and modest. I'm not going to go according to the expectations that my friends have. The girl has to be outgoing, also go with you here, go with you there. It is totally acceptable, for example, to be, you know, in bars and go places where God would not like to see his servant. I don't have to go by the expectations of my friends, of my co-workers, or people around me. Again, I will have to look at the values that the Prophet is telling us to look at. So your standards versus the standards of others and society at large. This is also a very important point to consider. Another important point to consider in regards to this one is As a future parent, as a future partner, you should be ready, character-wise, financial-wise, and above all, religious-wise, to get married to your future partner. We have youth who would say, Imam, find me a partner, because I'm looking to get married. I'm 20 years old, 21, 22, 23, whatever. I feel that pressure from society, from the people around me and all that. I need to get married. However, the character is not built yet. First, look at the character. Build your own powerful character first. Shady character will result in conflict later on in life with your partner. Build some financial foundation, some good financial foundations. Look for a good job out there. Start earning some good income in order for you to be reliable when you have your partner in the future in life. Be strong. If you did not learn your own faith and you're looking to get married to somebody who's religious, you are in the baby steps in your own religion, stop first. Learn your deen very well. Learn the commands very well, what Allah tells you to do and what He prohibits you from staying away from. Learn the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Take some courses, take some classes. Be knowledgeable about your own faith first, then marry somebody who's also religious. This way, you will understand where she's coming from, and she will also understand where you're coming from. But not only that, you will be able, as partners in life, to develop great skills as believers, or to implement the taqwa, to implement righteousness, God awareness that is asked from every single individual. You will be able to develop that through the partnership in life, through being coupled in life. And the last thing that I would mention here is also to consider the point, where do we look to have a good girl, a good wife in the future, or a good husband? You also have to pay attention to the places where you look. There would be Muslims who are looking in wrong places. So you have to, because in wrong places, there are wrong people going there. In good places, there are good people going there. It's a very simple, it's a simple thing. So look for the good places to find the good people. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who make the right decisions in life, and who make these decisions based upon the divine inspiration that is mentioned to us in the Holy Book, in the Quran, and the prophetic guidance. ألا إن أحسن الكلام أبلغ النظام كلام الله الملك العزيز العلام كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى في الكلام بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الدين عند الله الإسلام استغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Dear brothers and sisters, lately there were some acts of terrorism happening in New York, in New Jersey, different places around the United States, and they are happening in daily basis around the world. We strongly condemn all of these acts of terrorism. We strongly condemn, and we mention that there is no base on Islam for any single act of terrorism that people would express to the others. Injuring others. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taslima. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim in Hamidu Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala Ali Ibrahim in Hamidu Majid. ورضى الله عن سادتنا أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن الصحابة أجمعين وعن أهل بيت رسول الله وعن التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمستمر الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم طهر قلوبنا واستر عيوبنا واشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين يا رب العالمين. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. عباد الله، يقول تعالى: إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروا يزدكم واستغفروه يغفر لكم وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر.